Most of my videos focus on one or a set of related maps, but in this video, we're going to look at some random old maps from the 16th to the 19th century that I just find interesting. Let's jump right in. Our first map here is a 1578 map of South America by Dutch cartographer Cornelis de Jode. It is the first map of South America to appear in a large commercial atlas. Some say that during this period, South America is shaped like a potato. Depicted here is Lake Titicaca. It's often called the highest navigable lake in the world. By volume of water and by surface area, it is the largest lake in South America, and today is shared by Bolivia and Peru. There are other place names on the map you may recognize, Chile and Peru, though their borders were a little different and under Spanish rule at the time, and Terra de Patagones, which we know as Patagonia. We'll come back to that in a minute. Several monsters are drawn on the map, which is common on 16th century maps. But my favorite features on this map are the bird's eye views of Cusco, the capital of the Inca Empire, and Tenochtitlan, the capital of the Aztec Empire. These were probably influenced by earlier depictions of the two cities, such as this 1572 view of both Cusco and Tenochtitlan. On Tenochtitlan, the author of this map wrote, "Mexico, or Tenochtitlan, is a rich and important city in New Spain in the Mexican provinces, lying in a saltwater lake. There are many heathen temples here, which their priests live in. The most important amongst them is a temple whose quite incredible magnificence is described in detail by Hernan Cortes. They make their heathen images out of flour or human blood, and every day sacrifice a large number of human hearts to them, which they cut out of the living bodies. A magnificent palace belonging to the most powerful lord, Montezuma, also stands here." In this image of Cusco, it shows the indigenous king being carried in his elevated chair near the town center. In the atlas this map came out of, the author wrote, "The capital of Peru in the south of the New World is Cusco, a city so large, powerful, and beautiful that it can easily rank alongside the most important cities in Spain and France. The streets are generally very straight and numerous crossroads, and a stream flows down most streets. The city is particularly embellished by a wonderful palace that lies on the steep hill and has no comparison in Europe." This 1610 map by Jodocus Handius has a nearly identical inset of Cusco. But this map also has some other interesting features. Like the prior map of South America we looked at, it shows Terra de Fuego, meaning land of fire. Ferdinand Magellan named this land after the many fires lit up by the local population when he sailed through the strait that would come to bear his name in 1520. But on this map, it's clear that it's supposed to belong to Terra Australis, a non-existent southern landmass. The Terra Australis theory already existed for nearly 2,000 years, and some believed Magellan's sightings of Terra de Fuego confirmed its existence. There is also what appears to be a native standing in southern South America. This is likely supposed to depict a giant, considering this image is similar to other maps of the period where the man being a giant is clear. This again goes back to Ferdinand Magellan's voyage. One man on the voyage wrote, "One day we saw a naked man of giant structure on the shore of the port, dancing, singing, and throwing dust on his head. When the giant was in the captain general's and our presence, he marveled greatly, and made signs with one finger raised upwards, believing that we had come from the sky. He was so tall that we reached only his waist." Other expeditions later reported similar sightings, and so the idea that giants lived in Patagonia lasted over 250 years. Our next map is a 1651 map of the Virginia colony. I should point out that north is pointed to the right on this map, not the top, which is standard today. The creator of the map, John Farrar, a prominent member of the Royal Company of Virginia, claimed that the Pacific Ocean was only a 10 days march away. This map combines the discoveries of Sir Francis Drake, who landed near modern-day San Francisco, which was named New Albion, and the mapping of British claims on the East Coast that had been done up until that point. There is the Hudson River at about the 40th parallel that connects to a lake with a short portage to the Pacific Ocean, and it may even reach the ocean here. Just like this part of the North American continent isn't this narrow, this passage to the Pacific Ocean of course doesn't exist. This was a bit of wishful thinking by Farrar, as well as other Europeans. After the discovery of the Americas, every powerful country in Europe wanted to find a faster route to Asia through or around the continent and control it before others could. This wasn't the first time a false theory about reaching the Pacific had been drawn on old maps, and it wasn't the last. This map is covered in native plants and animals, though some of the sea monsters are questionable. Sea monsters are all over maps from the 15th through the 17th centuries. This 1539 map of the Nordic countries is one of the most famous for its monsters. Monsters were typically put on maps to decorate the blank parts, such as the oceans, but this map served to highlight these monsters. Some of these monsters were purely mythical, while others were distortions of real animals. Let's take a look at a few of them. The Xiphias. It had the head of an owl and the body similar to a whale. They would apparently go out of their way to bore holes in ships, sinking them. The Prister, which was also supposed to be a whale, but it could blow out so much water that it could sink a ship by flooding it. The Sea Unicorn, which was obviously supposed to be a narwhal. Here is another map famous for its monsters, which is largely based on the map just shown. It's of Iceland and was published in 1570 by Abraham Ortelius. The Seahorse. The description on the back of this map states that it often causes great hurt and scare to fishermen. The Stackgall. The description states, the Dutch call it Springgall. It has been observed to stand for a whole day long upright on its tail. It derives its name from its leaping or skipping. It is a very dangerous enemy of seamen and fishermen, and greedily goes after human flesh. Here's one of my favorites, though I'm not sure how to pronounce it. It was said to be so large that it was like an island, and could overturn ships with its fins. This one isn't a monster, but I thought it was still an interesting addition to the map. Huge and marvelous big heaps of ice, brought here by the tide from the frozen sea, making loud and terrible noises. Some pieces are often as big as 40 cubits. On some of these, white bears sit together, watching the innocent fish play about and exercise. I actually have a video where I go through every monster on this map that I made for members and Patreon patrons. This next map is one from my personal collection. It's from a 1624 atlas of the ancient world. The map shows the route of Abraham from Ur to Shechem, the wandering children of Israel, the pyramids of Egypt. There is also an inset of the known world showing the before-mentioned southern landmass Terra Australis, and beside the inset, tents of nomadic Tartars. Around the outside of the map, written in Latin, is information on important places on the map. This map was again the work of Abraham Ortelius. Our next map is a 1738 map of London. It's titled, A View of London About the Year 1560. The map has a key identifying over 80 place names, such as churches, streets, and bridges. A bull and bear baiting pit is shown on the south bank. You can clearly see the Tower of London. But my favorite part is the Old London Bridge, when it had structures from one side of the Thames to the other. This is another map in my personal collection. It is a 1619 map by Gerardus Mercator of the Zeeland province in the Netherlands. This map depicts the war with the sea that the Netherlands has been fighting for centuries. Walcheren is still an island. Land reclamation has since turned it into the end of a peninsula. There are towns shown on this map, though they are under the water. Towns here were taken by the sea in 1530 by a flood that reportedly killed over 100,000 people. This next map is much newer, and another in my personal collection. It's a map of the former range of the American bison. This map was published in 1889 in William T. Hornaday's book, Extermination of the American Bison. He sent this book and map to congressmen to persuade them to take action. Hornaday was a key player in preventing the bison from going extinct. Different symbols represent different periods of time and reasons for the extinction. The bison once reached further east than the Appalachian Mountains, and as far south as Mexico. But by the time this map was published, the bison only had a few isolated pockets of territory. This is a 1636 map of China and its surrounding area by Yoda Cassandius. As usual, there's another impressive monster. Above that is the crucifixion of a Christian by the Japanese. The annotation describes how Christians were persecuted for their beliefs in Japan. To the left of it is, of course, Japan. And next to Japan is Korea. Though, interestingly, Korea is drawn as an island, not a peninsula, which we know it to exist as today. Our last map is what is often referred to as America's birth certificate. It was published by a German cartographer in 1507, and it was the first map to use the name America. The accuracy is pretty impressive. You can make out North and South America. Here is what we know today as Cuba, Jamaica, and the island of Hispaniola. And this appears to be Florida, which is interesting because Europeans did not officially make contact with Florida until 1513. The only known copy of this map was purchased by the United States Library of Congress in 2001 for $10 million. Thank you, RareMaps.com, for giving me high-definition images and the history of many of the maps in this video. Also, if you haven't already, you can check out my other old map videos here. Shout out to all my Patreon and YouTube members for supporting the channel, and thank you all for watching.